Welcome to lecture four, new series of 20. We are joined today, very pleased, joined today by a good friend and colleague, Linda Wells. You've had her before, right?
Yes, at least half. At least half of this class.
Excellent. So you're in for a treat. I'm going to try to make my part fast and furious. First order of business, you guys did a fantastic job with the Bruce Sanjanagia sketch in-class exercise. Congratulations, thank you for your excellent work. It's going to serve you well in doing the sketch assignments, which are due the same day as the exam, which is a week from today.
Oof.
So heads up, sketch assignments, your first three sketches are due the same day as the exam, and that day is next Tuesday. And for those of you who did not pick up the new improved version of the syllabus, there's a few left there. For those of you who have done it twice, you can put one back just to make sure your colleagues have one. But the only change in this new version of the syllabus are the due dates for the assignments. So we have exams, we have sketch assignments, and we also have a writing assignment. The writing assignment, the first of two writing assignments for the course, should be in your hands if you enter the room. The first page describes what's expected for the writing assignment, and the second page shows the four questions that you are expected to respond to, and the rubrics, the rubric by which you will be evaluated, by which your response will be evaluated. Now, this talks mostly about the outcome for the undergraduates are a short piece of writing. It's deceptive. You think that 120 to 180 words is easy, right? It's easy to write 120. It's only a few sentences. But heads up, these few sentences have to do a lot of work. They have to take care of a lot of business. If you've written a lot before, you will recognize the challenge here is that there's a lot of meaning that has to be boiled down and articulated with great clarity and care in a very short number of words. The challenge of this writing assignment is not that there are a lot of words. The challenge of this writing assignment is that you have to do it in so few words. Crazy, right? Welcome to college, where effective writing is all about being clear and succinct. So to prepare us for this challenge, we have an in-class exercise that you also have in your hands. This in-class exercise is basically a dress rehearsal for the writing assignment. This breaks down into six easy steps, not so easy, but six clear steps of how to be an effective writer, how to produce an effective piece of writing for the writing assignment. So you have four questions that you need to respond to in the writing assignment that is due a week after the exam. So you have about 2 weeks to do this. But for each one, this is the recommended procedure. And so to practice and get ready for that, to prepare for success on this first writing assignment, we're going to do this in class with looking at this specific building that will be one of the stars of today's lecture. Okay? Any questions before we jump in? Okay. Yes, question.
I What building is it?
You'll see. I don't want to give away the surprise.
Yes.
Are these in-class exercises graded?
Are these in-class exercises graded?
No, not specifically. They're a great way to take attendance. They're a great way to confirm photo attendance. It's a great way, it's first and foremost, what it is, it's practice for you guys. I do pay attention to some of the standout efforts, and I am collecting them for use as examples for next year's group. So there is an informal sense of who's really putting in the effort rises to the top. The more effort you put into this, the more successful you will be when you are being graded in the writing assignments and in the exams. Okay? Other questions? Great questions. Okay.
Bump into that one.
We turn the lights down?
Yeah. You do that? You like this one? This setting?
That looks good.
You like
yeah.
that?
They can see, we can see.
Okay, now how do I get to... What happened to my... Okay, I'm going to get rid of this altogether. So I'm going to present... Let me grab it. So what happened to our presentation? Oh.
Voila.
Voila.
Voila. The tour is there.
Okay. So
as always, we start with a little bit of advice on how to succeed in this class, which if we are upholding our end of the bargain, is connected with how you succeed in this school, which if the school is upholding its end of the bargain, is related to how do you succeed in your careers and in your life. So when you see 17 buildings go by you in a lecture, what should you do? Any suggestions what we should do for 17 buildings? Should we frantically write down the names of each of those buildings and memorize it? No. You can't afford to. You've broken into a wealthy person's house. The police are on their way. You have to grab the cash, the jewels, and get out. What's important? Is the year of the birth of the architect important? Maybe, but probably not. Okay? So choose what matters to you most. In this lecture, there is at least one building that is the focus of your in-class exercise that I am proposing is important. And I suggest, at a bare minimum, you memorize the identity of this building. then your job is to figure out why you would care. Like, other than being part of the in-class exercise, and other than it might show up on a quiz, it might show up on an assignment, why do you care? What's important about this?
We're saying this is an important building for your success in school and career. We might be right, we might not be right. You have to make up your minds yourselves. We're number four. We're doing our best to support your education, but you're the one ultimately responsible for your own education. Here's what we suggest you take care of. So in every case, if there's a candidate for your precious attention, if it's something that should end up in your pocket as you crawl back out the window of this program, then it should be something you memorize, and you better have a sense of what the architecture does and how the architecture does it. And the reason we know this is important is because Linda and I challenge our thesis students for the entire final year of the thesis program. We say, what is your architecture doing and how is it doing it? And we ask that of our thesis students day in and day out. So get used to it. To the extent that architecture matters at all, it matters because it does certain things, and it does it in ways that nothing else can do. So, we also understand that there's only so much that you can get out of the textbook, there's only so much you can get out of these lectures, but we give these lectures to you online on Blackboard. They serve as a valuable visual, mainly visual resource or recap of what we think in this school is important in the history of architecture. Please forgive me if I gloss over most of the slides that I'm about to show you. I'm trying to make room for the incredibly valuable thing that Linda is about to show you. So again, I'm using red to say, here's what's important. The Industrial Revolution. You will recall from previous lectures that people were inventing things all over the world for thousands of years, but sometimes these new ideas were not rewarded. Sometimes the inventors were executed, as they did in France, because it threatened the power structure. It took the Glorious Revolution in England around 1688 to displace the monarchy and establish a parliamentary system of government and respect for the intellectual property rights of individuals, such that the incentive structure was suddenly created to innovate and to profit from that innovation. And so the things that I'm pointing out here is what happened during the Industrial Revolution. It's not just William Curtis, but it's also William Morris, who we'll hear more about later, who said the Industrial Revolution is great for some things, but it's really causing damage. It's disconnecting us from our craftsmanship, just like John Ruskin that we talked about last time. We're going to talk a lot about iron, wrought iron, and steel in this lecture. And one of the things that is not often talked about in the history of architecture around the Industrial Revolution is that one of the big things driving the Industrial Revolution is this vast labor pool that is the result of the end of the feudal system of landholdings. If you go one direction or the other down the street, you're going to run into the middle of a town. And what do you find in the middle of a town around here? What?
A store.
And then next to the store, there's the town hall. And next to the town hall, there's a
church.
And all of these things are arranged around a what?
A plaza. What's the New England name for a plaza? The center of the town where you grew up. Thank you. Points here, points there.
Okay, so the town common, it's called the common. Why is it called the common? Because it's held in common. It's nobody's private land. Unless they change the rules, you can take your cow there still and graze your cow on that land. Try it. It used to be that most humans in England farmed land that they did not own. But they would give a certain percentage of the produce of that to the feudal lord. And that was true until the laws of enclosure, which drove people off the land, drove them into cities, big labor supply for Industrial Revolution, one of the big factors. And so here, this image shows us
before there were pickup trucks and cars and vast parking lots outside the factory, there were vast oceans of worker housing. The corporate entities had to build the factory, but they also had to build the housing for the factory workers and the church to keep everybody being morally upright, etc. But this is the typical arrangement of cities, and we're going to get into this a lot greater detail on Thursday. So women made up a big part of the workforce, and the innovations of all this suddenly led to a dramatic drop in the cost of producing iron products. For all of human history, we've had all of these things. We've had cast iron, wrought iron, steel, basically, the difference between cast iron, wrought iron, and steel is how much carbon is in each. If you just melt the iron ore, there's an awful lot of carbon, and so anything more than 2.1% carbon, that's cast iron. And it's crystalline in structure, very hard, but it's brittle, so it doesn't work very well in cannons. They will explode unexpectedly, and as soon as you stress something in cast iron, like a bridge, it will shatter. So in architectural, we often prefer to use wrought iron because it's better in tension and it's more ductile. How do you get all that carbon out? You hammer it with a sledgehammer under heat, and it pounds the iron into striated sheets like a croissant. And the most famous wrought iron building of all time, yes, the Eiffel Tower. No time for this. So cast iron is very, this is a summary of the whole cast iron story. It will be online. It's excellent in compression, lousy in tension. Don't put it in tension. Treat it like it's a brick. And when it fails suddenly. It leads to what we call in the engineering and architectural industry catastrophic failure, as opposed to non-catastrophic failure. Cast iron was revolutionary because it was so strong, but yet relatively light. So its strength to weight ratio was extremely high. It made possible very slender structures that could span long distances. So all of a sudden, all of these challenges of the new programs we've been talking about in the Enlightenment period, train stations and libraries and all of these things, these large spaces suddenly become much easier to accomplish. It's fire resistant, and you can cast multiple panels and send it off to the colonies. So you see cast iron structures all over the world, including the French colonies. Here's an interesting foreshadowing of what lies ahead, where cast iron is so versatile, you can make it look like other materials. In this case, bamboo. We've seen cast iron in action in Le Bruce's 1843 Library of Saint-Geneviève in Paris. In the thin arches and columns that sit on top of the masonry structure.
This is really a schizophrenic architecture. It's the familiar masonry solid solidity that has been around for centuries. Suddenly, there's a new game in town, and it's called cast iron. Cast iron allows us to create very highly sculptural forms because it's cast. You carve the form in wood, you press it into sand, and you allow the molten iron to flow into the sand, it'll take that shape. So lots of stuff happens in the Industrial Revolution, including the railway system and bridges. So what's interesting here is that because cast iron is great at compression, lousy at tension, you have to treat it like it's masonry, which means you create arches, just like Saint-Geneviève. The first iron, cast iron bridges were made in arch form to keep every member in pure compression. Someday we'll bring back the sugar cube exercise. So when you see a form, when someone asks you, is this cast iron or wrought iron? And you can just look at the form, and if it's arched, and if it's decoratively produced like this in curved shapes, you can say cast iron, and you probably are right. So this is just saying that there are lots of new programs. The market halls are the big one, and I'm going to move very quickly. Apologies for those of you who are big fans of market halls. This is an interesting example in that it is almost the same size as the Pantheon. And if you are ever looking for an example of a schizophrenic architecture, you can say Saint-Geneviève, it's heavy masonry on the outside, light iron structure on the inside. This is an interesting example. It's the same footprint and scale as the Pantheon, one of the heaviest but most accomplished compressive structures in the world. But here we have it done a very similar form. We see it done in cast iron. And a lot of spaces are covered using cast iron. It makes for very good greenhouses and shopping arcades midway through the block. An interesting coincidence, or is it a coincidence, is that these arcades showed up in Paris around the same time as Napoleon and his armies were marching through Egypt, including Cairo and Alexandria and other cities where the most prominent feature at the center of the city is the covered shopping street or souk. What do you think? Do you think it's a direct connection?
It's never direct.
Think we're doing any damage to imply that it might be?
No.
Okay, so we're speculating. We're just number four. If you're interested, go verify. So lots of beautiful stuff happening both in Paris and here in the United States. Have you been there? It's from Providence, one of the first arcaded shopping areas in North America. So it's everywhere. And the common theme is we have to dress up our architecture with masonry formality of in the neoclassical style as almost as if to compensate for this offensive, potentially offensive new utilitarian architecture of cast iron. Like it's awfully factory-like. Let's dress it up with very fancy curlicues in the castings and then really emphasize the masonry bits. So outside in the entry, you have a triumphal arch almost as if to compensate for the utilitarian shed-like character of the lightweight cast iron structures inside. Now a new thing is happening here. It's still arched, but in some ways, there's still a little bit of arching that's going on here. These are cast pieces because wrought iron is hammered, and it's difficult to produce two-directional curvature in wrought iron. The hammering is very tough and it's expensive. But when you start to see these truss-like structures, these X braces of truss structures, now we're talking wrought iron. So if you get a question, is it wrought iron or cast iron? If it looks lattice-like or cross-bracing truss-like, you do well to say wrought iron. If an engineer disagrees with you, go along with what she says because she studies this more closely. But 9 times out of 10, I think you're gonna do pretty well. This is probably cast iron because of the form, and this is probably wrought iron because the structure is considered to be a wrought iron. It is a wrought iron structure. I question the sanity of mixing wrought iron and cast iron because they behave completely differently. If I were an engineer, I'd watch out for fractures where the wrought iron and the cast iron are connected because they behave completely differently. Cast iron does not budge, a little bit for thermal expansion. But wrought iron is ductile. You load it, it says, ooh, and it's slightly elastic. So here we see Leal in Paris. So market halls. This is one of the largest structure in wrought iron that we've seen. Again, it's a mixture of wrought and cast iron. And then we move from these arcades and shopping streets to the department store. And the Bon Marché department store in Paris employed Gustave Eiffel in its construction. A quick foreshadowing of what's going to happen on Thursday is these department stores became the social media of the 19th century. It was a great place to shop, but it performed a much larger social function. It was a place to see other people dressed in their fancy clothes and to be seen. It was the Facebook of the 19th century. It was a reflection of the increasing class of citizens who had money. Previously, you just had the wealthiest 1/10 of 1% of nobility. Then you had the peasants and very little in between. We're getting back there, but in the meantime, there's still a bourgeoisie that suddenly they have enough money. We now call these people the consumer culture class, the consumer class. And these grand staircases at the center of these architectural constructions were wrought iron staircases. We call it bougie now. Do you guys say that? My daughter says it. Okay, next type are the train stations. The train stations were built in the 19th century, and they were not at the center of town, but they would come up to the developed edge of the center, and that's where they would locate, because it was too expensive to build a train station where a lot of the center city already existed. And again, repeating something I've said previously, there is a hypersensitivity to creating this formal neoclassical facade on the front to conceal what has become a very lightweight modern structure. We've seen this before, St. Pancras Station. And here's the back, the train shed part of St. Pancras Station. There are two different architects working on this, one to do the neo-Gothic front and one to produce the train shed. Here's the train shed now. And here you see the two architectures not quite even touching. They're two very distinct architectures and enough space between them so that there's room to expand and contract. St. Pancras Station is copied pretty directly in the Victoria Terminus in Bombay. Again, we've seen this in the Neo-Gothic lecture. And so the train shed is completely separate from the front, the Neo-Gothic front. Now, here's a radical situation that we're going to see again today, where they start to say, well, why can't the train shed and the station entry portal into the city, why can't they relate to each other a little bit in a more friendly manner? So you get the Gare du Nord train shed being reflected ever so slightly in the roof form of the entry portal. And then Cubitt's King Cross Station, he's saying, listen, I'm going to let it all hang out. I'm going to be bold and modern. I'm going to take the double arches of the train shed and I'm going to express it right there on the facade. Call me crazy, but I'm going to do it. And so this is an extremely bold, modern move. Note the year, 1851. Which is the same year as the Great Exposition. So here we get to the star of my part of the lecture, Joseph Paxton's Crystal Palace. Paxton was a gardener, a landscape architect. He was not trained as an architect or an engineer. He had a problem he needed to solve, and with all the experience he had had with greenhouse, he said, I'm going to use greenhouse technologies to build this Great Exposition Hall. This Great Exposition Hall plays a very important role in establishing both for the citizens of Great Britain, named such in 1707, used to be England, now it's Great Britain because it's more of an empire. It has Great Britain, the British Empire extends around the planet. The sun never sets on the British Empire. And this was their chance to claim global domination in a piece of architecture and an event in 1851. So they build the biggest greenhouse ever built using wrought iron and cast iron pieces. And they create, they have to keep this elm tree in the center, and Paxton says, no problem, I do greenhouses. We'll just make the ceiling very, very high. So here is my summary of what the Crystal Palace does, and it's my job to convince you by showing you how it does it. And so it does what it does. It, in five different ways, is a demonstration. It uses the demonstration effect. It doesn't argue in favor, it just shows. It just says, here's the way it is. It's the largest cathedral ever built, if you forgive the use of the word cathedral, but it uses the cruciform, the elongated cruciform plan, as if it were a cathedral to the Industrial Revolution. It demonstrates the power of mass production assembly line. First, there's an assembly line to create all the modular pieces in the factory. Then there's an assembly line in the construction. It demonstrates in the contents of the hall British superiority over every other emerging nation state. Germany, don't make me laugh. France, nice try. But British is reigns supreme. It then displays the commodities it's gathering from its global empire of colonial holdings. And finally, it's establishing the British picturesque conquest of technology. It's saying, technology is okay. We are civilizing technology and making it fundamentally British. So there's a cultural project here to make, to tame technology so it's more than just a polluting factory ravishing the landscape. It's actually an element of civilization. So here's the evidence of the first thing. It's shaped like a giant cathedral. You'll see in the floor plan, I think, later, the double cruciform plan. Here's the image we used to say, to show how it was assembled. These structural rails, these structural beams are not just structural beams, they're also rain gutters. They collect the water and take the rain away. But they're not just structural and rain gutters, they're also rails upon which the glazier's trolley runs for the rapid installation of all of these glass panels. Remarkably clever. Next, it's demonstrating in the contents of the hall the supremacy of British ingenuity and all of these innovations in the machine hall. And it's also organizing things to demonstrate the global reach of the British Empire. If you can see it, you see the word India, China, other locations where the British have strongholds and they are gathering the commodities, the produce of a global network, bringing them to England for processing in the factories and then distributing them back out, not just in England, but also throughout the colonial network. And you'll see in this, if you can see it, silks and other products, some of the spoils of pillaging the artworks of the East. And then finally, the taming of technology and civilizing the technology, bringing it into the landscape in what Leo Marx called the machine in the garden. It is a cultural project of taking the innovations of the technological revolution and making them English, making them suitable for English cultural consumption. It's consumed in a fire, what year, 54?
I'd say 53.
It was very soon after the exposition. It has since been rebuilt, just recently rebuilt, in a new site, I think.
Didn't they move it first?
Well, maybe they moved it, then it burned?
Then it burned.
Oh, that's pathetic. So you'll notice on the in-class exercise, it says six things. This is to remind you that, I'm number four, I don't know. Each one of these things could be split and added to, distinguished, where we kind of did it in multiple different ways. And this is an incomplete list. These are my top five. What does the architecture do and how does it do it? There are more for you to choose from. So that's deliberately the five in the lecture is different from the six in the in-class exercise. Questions about that? So you are invited to identify which one of these five deserves to be split further, or which things are missing that maybe could be added to the list. The writing exercise that you will be doing to submit 2 weeks from now invites you, actually requires you to look at, you should look at the lecture materials, you should look at the textbook. There are readings on Blackboard. Each lecture topic has additional readings that we offer to you for deeper study. And we also invite you to look for other sources that are not the textbook, not on Blackboard. It's something you identified and found. And so there are opportunities to go deeper than we're able to go in the lecture, and that each one of you is expected to take on a different agenda, a different set of issues that somehow capture your imagination that you encounter looking more deeply into the topics, the four topics listed in the writing exercise. Questions about that? So back to the whirlwind tour, Eiffel Tower, who's been there? Who's been to the one in Las Vegas? Great waffles, the cinnamon waffles. 1889, Eiffel Tower, Paris, wrought iron, Got it? Great topic to dig in more deeply, especially how did the French react?
So I just said, so you could deal with this as part of the Crystal Palace. In the Crystal Palace, the British are trying to say, listen, technology is okay, it's British. It fits in with our trajectory of the English landscape. The French have a completely different traditional landscape. They like formal lines, they're very neoclassical, especially after Napoleon. What's with this? Right? How did the people of France react to this crazy intrusion into their beloved city? It's a fascinating topic. No time. So Gustav Eiffel did not just do the tower, he also did stuff all over the world in wrought iron mainly. So more train stuff, more bridges, these are all, this is a bowstring truss that combines cast iron and wrought iron. And here we are. Not bad.
So I'm going to use this unless I wander around. Okay.
And then you can use that. What do you want this?
Maybe that would be good. So I know some of you. It should be about half of you. Maybe I will get to know some more of you if you decide to join the graduate program, because the other class that I've been teaching for the last few years has been thesis prep, where Robert again is my boss. I have to have him as my boss wherever I turn. But one of the terrific things about teaching these history courses is that it requires me to travel around, because we now are asked to demonstrate that we teach global architectural history. And that's a huge change from when I was an undergrad, and probably from when you were an undergrad, Robert, where we really looked at Egypt, Greece, Western Europe, and North America and called it quits. And then we'd say, oh yeah, Japan's over there and China's over there too. We know a few things about Japan and China, and the rest of it just, is that architecture? They have buildings, but maybe not architecture. Well, what we didn't know was what we didn't know, which is a huge amount of architecture throughout the world. And now we're starting to realize not just I'm going to call them vernacular forms, but the reach of what was Western form. And this Age of Iron is a great, great opportunity to start to talk about global issues beyond what we used to teach in undergraduate programs. And I didn't have an orientation towards Vietnamese and Cambodian architecture as an undergraduate. So when I went to Vietnam a year and a half ago, I had few preconceptions and I came away with a lot of questions. And it really is an important segue into the thinking that we are trying to get you to do through both writing and sketch exercises, which is to be critical. The notion is not to be thinking, this is what I have to write, this is what I have to memorize, this is what I have to learn, but how do I learn this? How do I start to think about this in ways that make it make sense for me? And how do I start to ask questions about what I see? So when I go to someplace like Vietnam and I see this enormous bridge, I think, what the heck is that doing there? Or how did that building get there? And one of the big questions for me when I was in graduate school and looking at Trinity Church here in Boston was, how did that pile of rock wind up in a swamp when in Chicago, they were starting to build 10-story buildings with iron skeletons and then steel skeletons. And Boston is still building something out of the medieval period. And then you turn around and with Trinity at your back, you look at the Boston Public Library and you think, how did that building get there in 1895? We're building a replica of a French urban dwelling. An Italian urban dwelling. So the whole notion of this is to get you to look at a building and say, how did that building get there? Why does it make any sense? And that's the hook. That's how you get hooked. That's how you start to learn about the building, is by saying, asking a question about it. And the good question can be, how did that building get there? Why is that building there? Why is Trinity Church a huge pile of rocks built on a swamp in Boston in 1877? Does not make any sense until you start to ask questions about the context, about the social environment that it was built in, and who was making the decisions, who was providing the money, and who was, say, in charge of the religious program. So it's these questions that are the basis of critical thinking, and critical thinking is part of what the essays and the sketches are meant to get started. So I go to Vietnam, and I did this, I prepared this lecture a year ago when Anne-Katrine was teaching the course in the summer. And I started to revisit it, a month or so ago when I got in touch with Robert and said, do you want this lecture again? It's one of these situations where you never give the same lecture twice, even if you read your notes, because hopefully you're always thinking about things in between. So I've used the basis of what I did last year. Robert's injected a few interesting things, so it's going to be a back and forth. But also, I've gotten also a reputation from Robert about being really picky about language. Sometimes just a word, sometimes it's the expression, but it's the language that we use to think about buildings that we see, so that our visual input and the way we choose to think about it in words gets very, very important to me. So I go to Vietnam and I come back with these ideas for a lecture, and the ideas really are questions. And that's how this part of the presentation today is formed, is around these questions that I came back with. But very briefly, I'm going to introduce you to some fundamental ideas about what was going on in Vietnam when the French were there in the New Age of Iron, and then look at the questions that I found compelling when I looked at Vietnamese architecture. So keep this image in your mind. This is a contemporary photograph of what is known as Ho Chi Minh City, or Saigon. Its original name was Saigon after the war with Vietnam and the United States. Its name was changed to Ho Chi Minh City. So your text approaches this New Age of Iron by looking at what Robert was showing you, greenhouses and arcades, but it's the expansion of structural possibilities in England and France. Mentioning some of the ideas of standardizations of parts. And one of the things I love about the Crystal Palace, being the image that you chose today, is this date of 1851 coinciding with the fact that that building is 1,851 feet long. So if you have worked in an office, and I think you guys just finished your co-op semester, so many of you have, one of the things you start to learn about is modularity and dimensions, and it really struck me as very odd that a building would be 1,851 feet long. Why wasn't it 1,850? Why wasn't it 1,852? And obviously it was meant to reflect the year in which it was built. So there's the hook. There's the question of you know, why isn't it 1,852 feet long? It would make sense to an architect, but in fact, it's the beginning of what I think of as extruded buildings. You can stretch it out and chop it off wherever you want. 1,851 feet. It's glass and iron, just like we have downtown, only you're extruding vertically. And when you run out of money, or when the city of Boston says you can't go any higher, or when your client says that's enough, you chop it off, you just like that. So these notions that come along with the structural material have resonance with what we're thinking about in the context in which all of this happens. I've chosen this particular time period because it brackets in Vietnam a couple of important dates, and one of them is the real intention of the French to colonize Vietnam, and the other is pretty much the end of when French influence and engineers ends in Vietnam. But I want to talk about a couple of the things as I introduce Vietnam. First of all, it is literally on the other side of the world. I don't know, has anybody visited there? Is anybody from Vietnam? A couple of years ago, I had a Vietnamese student, but it's fairly unusual. But in fact, the great thing about traveling there is if you've got an analog watch, you don't have to change it. When you arrive, if it's 12 a.m. that you've got on your watch, it really is 12 p.m. It really literally is on the other side of the world. And then climate is the other issue. Climate is so different from what we're used to here in New England, but probably many of you have lived in climates that are not the tropical climate that Vietnam experiences. So the other thing to keep in mind is that that lets you think about buildings in a different way. Not everything has to be enclosed all the time. And the country is not just one climate, but north and south have different temperature ranges, and there is a mountainous area that does get cool. But it is a tropical climate for the most part with rainy season. And it's not monsoon rains, but it is a rainy season that has significance for things like transportation. This is where I start the bracketing of what I'm going to talk about, when the French get really interested in Vietnam. And it's this period that coincides with what we're calling the New Age of Iron. And there are two important dates that are not on here. Oops. One is, I'm going to say 1860, when a French explorer, and I love this word, and this is where I would love another word, but I can't come up with it, discovers the Watts in Cambodia. And did he discover them? Or did he uncover them? Did he trip over a stone that led him? But in any case, it's a marker for the French interest in Vietnam. And it goes on to be something that the French capitalize on for tourism. And in fact, the temples in Angkor play a role in the development of French tourism. And in the 19th century, when there are a lot of world's fairs, the French capitalize on it again with a reconstruction of the Angkor Wat. And the second date is 1882, when the French take the citadel in Hanoi. And it's the mission of colonization that is imposing French culture in Vietnam. And 1882 is a significant date for another reason. It is the date of the construction of the Rainbow Bridge. And think back to that very first image that I showed you. This is the same bridge. This is a bridge designed by Monsieur Eiffel's establishment. And think about the Eiffel Tower. It, in Ms. Seriefeld's words, is a bridge stood upright. So his firm is designing bridges as well as the Eiffel Tower. This predates the Eiffel Tower by 7 years. Another hook for thinking about the Eiffel Tower is that it's built to commemorate the French Revolution. It's 100 years later. Easy to remember that date. It's 100 years, exactly 100 years after the French Revolution that the tower, Eiffel Tower is built. So this is the same engineer, the same designer. It's a bridge a halfway around the world. It's imposing French culture. It can be constructed elsewhere, put on ships as ballast, taken halfway around the world, and constructed with the intent of easing the French, I'm going to say capturing of this territory. So French industrialists, French capitalists, those who wanted to invest elsewhere were eased into Vietnam through the construction of bridges, canals, trolleys, tramways. Iron was the perfect material for colonization. And that's the sort of the bracketing of these dates for looking at Vietnam. So these are the three questions that kind of came to my mind as I tried to process what I had seen and what I had read and what we talked about in visiting Vietnam. The question of size, and I don't like that word size, I'm gonna use scale, but if you've got better ideas, but it's all of a sudden iron introduces the possibility of long spans, bridges, but also interior spaces. And with glass, you can have interior spaces that have a lot of light. So it changed the quality of interior spaces when glass and iron were used together. And then the question of style. And again, style is a word that gives me a lot of problems. I wouldn't use the word style, except I'm a question of manner of design, the question of choice of design. So if there's a better word than style, I'd love to use it. I just can't come up with it right now, but perhaps manner, the question of how things should be designed when you have iron and steel as structural materials. And you saw that when Robert was talking about railroad stations, there sort of had to be this mask of something that people were comfortable with, that they could look at and they could say, oh, that's classical. Maybe I could go in this building. And I think there was also a certain amount of discomfort with, can I really believe that iron is going to hold up the roof? If I only see it, maybe I'm a little scared to go in that building. But if it's clad with stone or brick, then it's believable and it's what I'm used to seeing. So the whole notion of how iron should look, how buildings should look, what was the manner of design, was a huge area of debate when iron started to be used as a structural material. And the whole notion of new building types, railroad stations and, you know, the Crystal Palace. What does a new building type look like? It had to be invented. We had to make mistakes, make buildings look like other buildings, and then say, oh, that makes no sense whatsoever to build a cathedral out of iron and glass. Yeah, a cathedral? Yeah, maybe so, I don't know. But it's a question that was not just debated verbally, but worked on. You know, some buildings that may have been explorations of this question we may no longer have with us. And then all of these things push the bigger question in my mind of urbanization, rapid urbanization. And in England, it's the Industrial Revolution. Hordes of people coming into cities had to be housed. They took a day off. What were they going to do on the day off? In New York, we gave them Central Park. But big questions about new building types. What were they supposed to look like? In Vietnam, the French introduced boulevards and new building types that were very, very close to what exactly what was going on in Paris at the time. But the pushback was the shop house, and I'll talk some more about that in terms of a really interesting question about co-opting something that is imposed on you and turning it to your own use. But so, question of size, the Rainbow Bridge, plopped in Saigon, in Ho Chi Minh City. All of a sudden, the scale, this is 1,000 feet long, bank to bank, this river may flood during the rainy season, but now you can get from one side of the city to the other. Or if, for example, the crossing of the river was only accomplished with ferry boats and in bad weather you couldn't do it. Now you've got a bridge, and it brings not just railroad cars, but people. Keep this bridge in mind. Keep the image of this bridge in mind. But also think about how, I'm going to go back to that, how this enclosure, this span, these larger spans and enclosure of interior spaces might change the culture or have an impact on the culture where previous construction was wood or stone or brick or bamboo. So now interior spaces with fewer columns and with columns that are much more slender can be achieved. Culturally, that's imposing a different idea. We were looking at Paris and England, where interior enclosures, the shopping arcades, changed the way people behaved. It wasn't just what people looked at. It wasn't just the form of the architecture. It really changed how people behaved. They went to the Beaumarchais to hang out. So if I asked you to describe the style or make a guess about the nationality, the designer of this building, what would you guess after what you've seen? You should have a pretty good clue. Who's got a guess? Nationality of the designer. Yeah. Yeah. It's got to be French, right? So it's the question of, but it's the question of what's the appropriate design for a building it halfway around the world from France in a completely different climate with different materials. But it is, in Ho Chi Minh City, it is a French, basically a French design. It's by a French architect. And it's an opera house. Maybe a new building type for Vietnam. In the 1897. I'm not sure. I saw somebody raise a hand who said he was Vietnamese. Not sure how far back opera goes in Vietnam, but I expect these are French operas anyway. Maybe German operas, but in fact European. And so this is urbanization. All of a sudden the scale of buildings is bigger, and there's a new building typology. This is an indoor market. And I'm saying that this is a question of urbanization because if I turned around, I didn't take this picture. Obviously, it's an older picture, but I did stand on this spot, and if I turned 180 degrees, this is my picture, and this is what I would have seen. So urbanization, when the French are colonizing, yeah, they put in a huge indoor market where maybe the idea of an indoor market was kind of a new thing in the, what's the date on this? 1906. Because in fact, the market is everywhere. And it's right on the street. It's not indoors. The sidewalks are the marketplaces. And this is a contemporary photo of that market. The original market had five of these I'm going to call them train station barrel vaulted constructs, and three remain. But if you raise your hand, you're Vietnamese, yeah, yeah. Do you know this building? It's huge. It's a huge interior enclosure. But that doesn't mean that the sidewalk markets go away. In fact, they're thriving as far as I can see. But there is this pushback. Not everything changes just because the French come in and colonize and want to impose French culture on the Vietnamese. The old quarter of Hanoi persists, and it really began as a, you know, a cluster of old streets and buildings when people began to move from the countryside into an urban area. Today it's called the area of 36 streets. You find this in other European cities where the streets are actually named after the type of craft or whatever the goods were that were sold on the street. But it's this organic development that would be typical of a city of the city before the French arrived and decided to impose their idea of urbanization. But it's an excellent example of what I want to talk about in terms of pushback and appropriating something from a different culture and making it your own. So those are the main three questions that I had, and I would love to work on the language about those questions, but basically I want to start there and perhaps that can get refined. But the question of scale or size of buildings, the question of what buildings need to look like when iron construction and French culture come together in a completely different climate and with a completely different culture. And then the issues raised by this rapid urbanization that was going on not only in Vietnam, but we saw images from Robert's earlier slides of urbanization in England, for example. And the reason I'm showing you this is it is what is called a shop house or a tube house. And it's the adaptation that came as urbanization pushed into Vietnam and in China. You'll also find the shop house. But what is interesting about it, it is the Southeast Asian expression of what happens when urbanization is so rapid that you've got to respond very quickly. It is a completely vernacular response to urbanization. So I'm going to look at each of those three questions in a little more depth. And first of all, I'm going to talk about the possibilities that come with long spans where previous structures were either bamboo, wood, or stone. And I started with the Rainbow Bridge. And I'm going to say, is this one of these curious instances of assimilation? Because now, in fact, the Rainbow Bridge is kind of a symbol for Ho Chi Minh City. And people go there to have their photograph taken with the bridge in the background. It's a little bit like the Eiffel Tower is for Paris. It is an icon for the city. So it's, you've got the French coming along, colonizing, imposing something that's very French, that aids the French imposition on the city. And 100 years later, it's turned into something that is really Vietnamese. It really identifies that city. So there have always been large spaces, and now I'm going just a little bit, this is a little bit further west to Cambodia. So large spaces are not new, but mostly they're exterior. Remember the climate, it's not gonna snow, it's not going to be so cold that you can't stand to be outdoors. So large scale spaces, but mostly exterior spaces. And stone construction. But look at what the enclosure of space starts to look like. And this is a corbelling. This is stone corbelling in Angkor Wat. And this is just, it would be post and beam. Where's my pointer? Here we go. So just a lintel, a column, and a lintel, column, and a lintel. But when you've got really hefty stone construction, it gets a little messy at the corners. It can be a little difficult to separate or add on new spaces. But it's pretty basic construction. But it's also limiting interior spaces, which when iron comes along, all of a sudden the enclosure of interior spaces, long spans with few and slender columns, changes the quality of that interior space, and it changes how people behave as well. And timber allows you to enclose interior space, and in fact, temple architecture throughout Vietnam was timber construction. But again, the interior spaces are relatively limited in size, and you'll have spaces with a number of columns. And once the triangulated roof truss came along, which was invented in the Hellenistic period and could achieve larger spans. But again, you would find interior spaces with a lot of columns. And a wood truss system does have its limits. So if I were Robert, and I'm not writing the quiz questions, but if I were Robert and I were going to write a quiz question for you, I would look at these images and I'd be thinking about the issues that come with imposing an iron structure in a culture that has had a tradition of timber or stone construction. And what would be the questions that I would ask? And how would I get those questions to get you to think about the cultural issues that are raised by the structural differences that come along with iron construction? So Monsieur Eiffel's bridge, long span. If you were to do a sketch of that, it would be easy. About two arches like this would be the cue to you. You'd think, okay, I get it. That's iron construction. Post and beam, column and lintel, stone or wood, or you could do a combination of iron and cast and wrought iron. Not so often used that way. And a truss could be wood, could be steel or iron, not stone. So I would think, okay, if I had someone drawing a roof truss, I could ask about which materials would be appropriate for the use of a truss system. Corbelling, is there wood corbelling? Does wood corbel? Nah, nobody ever does it. It doesn't make sense. Yeah? Okay. So I think corbelling, what could I ask about corbelling? Where else have you guys seen corbelling? You go back to the Treasury of Atreus. Corbelling is used fairly commonly before larger spans are needed, or if they're needed at all. So a lot of interesting questions to do with how these different structural systems work with each other or don't work with each other. And then what's the follow-on with the cultural implication, either in Vietnam or in Paris, where all of a sudden life moves indoors into the department store or the galleries? So the second big question for me is, so what are these buildings gonna look like? And that is obviously a question that was struggled with in Europe and England, not just in countries that are colonized like Vietnam or what Brazil colonized with iron. New building typologies, huge interior spaces, and the big thing that the French architects were in charge of the new construction in urban areas. So the imposition of French ideas of what buildings should look like in the late 19th century. So if I were to ask you where you think either of these churches might be located, what's a guess on this one? Where would, what's an easy answer to where this church might be?
Germany.
Say it louder.
Germany.
Good guess. Another excellent. Yeah, Matt. France. Maybe England. And on the left, we've got this brick church. What's a guess about where that might be? Say it louder.
New England.
New England. Exactly. Or again, maybe Germany, or maybe England. But all good guesses. But in fact, these buildings are all in Vietnam. And it's what I was getting at with, you know, the design of these new buildings comes from French architects. Even the names are from France. So if I asked you to guess about the identity of this building or its location, anybody want to give me a guess? I mean, it almost seems like you should have seen this building in some of Robert's slides, right? It's a dead ringer for where would you guess this building was? Anybody got a guess? Matt, you've got a guess. So how did you know that?
That was in Robert's slides.
Yeah, right, okay. But, well, when we were previewing, we did see some. So it is, in fact, the post office in Ho Chi Minh City. But it's a dead ringer for the Bibliothèque Saint-Geneviève in Paris. There it is. And on the exterior, again, you see this sort of schizophrenia about, you know, the interior, you can express the iron structure, but there's got to be this slice on the exterior that people can say, oh, I get it. Yeah, there's an arch there. The building will stand up. So in my mind, there's almost this schizophrenia that's going on at this period that helps people get into the building or into the train station. And then you can say it's an engineering feat because it's the train shed, and you sort of switch mentalities and you say, oh, okay, an engineer did this and it's not going to fall down. But, you know, there are clear connections to other centuries here. This just, it does not make sense for the, what is this, very end of the 19th century. So iron marks the industrial function of the building, and it is also put to decorative use. Look at this. This is amazing. This is a Corinthian capital. I don't know what this is, but it's sort of these pieces that are reminiscent of other designs that I think are meant to make you feel comfortable, that are meant to make you help you make peace with the iron structure. So the Opera House in Ho Chi Minh City should remind you, the design should remind you of buildings that you have seen, that you saw Gare du Nord. Didn't you have that one, Robert? Yeah. But the real knockout here is the interior of the Opera House. So what was the date on this? 1897. So this is the interior of the Opera House in Ho Chi Minh City. Originally, it seated 1,800 people. That's a lot of people. If you consider that this auditorium holds 200 at a stretch. So there was a huge number of people in an interior space in 1897. And look at how decorative this is. This, it goes over the top in decorative motif. It's no longer the Bibliothèque Saint-Geneviève with the barrel exposed, the iron structure exposed. It is meant to tell you this is French. And I expect at this period it could have been lit with electricity, but I bet there wasn't any air conditioning. So you gotta really be invested in French culture to come to the Opera House and enjoy yourself. And your text calls this, this is the presidential palace, and it, your text calls it a competent essay in classicism. But its real importance lies not in the labeling of what this design looks like or the style. And again, I'm trying to get away from that word style, but the real importance lies in the fact that it is an assertion of the French presence and power in Vietnam. And think about what I showed you with the contrasting of the interior market and the indoor market and the outdoor market. Everything, life was on the street, life was on the sidewalks. And here we have a building that not only looks French, but it's removed from the street. There's a gate at the street. There's a flight of steps that goes up to the building. Everything about this building and its setting tells you this is not part of Vietnamese life. It is French, and we're making all of that evidence evident to you. And these elements of detail that are also very French. The column is a design that was done a couple of centuries previous to this by Philibert Delorme, where he's saying that, well, the French column is different from the Roman or Greek column. It has this band because, in fact, in France, we don't have the kind of stone that lets you have a single piece of stone make a column. It has to be built up out of drums, and we're showing you the collar of every drum. And we know that the Greeks built their columns up out of drums, and the Romans did it as well. If you go to any site where there is the ruin of a Greek temple, you will see the drums. So Philibert Delorme was being a little conceited when he was saying, oh, the French have it this way. This is identifiable as French. But if you're going to put this in a country halfway around the world, you want to make sure that people understand we're doing everything in the French way. So if I were Robert and I were to ask you a quiz question and give you this image and say I was going to make this worth 3 points, discuss this image. Tell me, what the hell's going on with this? You know, label it. There's a Corinthian, whoops. Yeah. That belongs to the Greeks, doesn't it? Maybe the Romans and Italians and maybe the French finally have it and do find it in England, but why is it something that is made out of iron that's to be imitating stone? And tell me some more about what this might mean culturally. I guess I was hinting at the one idea I have, which is it's trying to make you feel comfortable. It's trying to give you a reference that you understand. When you have this very skinny column that, in fact, it still can't hold something up. But I think this is a Robert, this is a perfect quiz question. What the heck is going on? This is, you can identify where it is, and then you could ask for, you know, you guys should have at least 3 ideas about why this is important, or why you should look at it and say, why is this here? why does it make any sense to use this in Ho Chi Minh City? All right, so finally, the issues of urbanization that, you know, it's not, I'm not going to show you a bridge and say that because we've got a bridge across the river and the rail lines can bring people and goods to the ports. I'm looking at more subtle things that, like the boulevards, like the difference between the 36th Street and the boulevards. But the pushback, and this is where it gets really interesting to me, the pushback, the persistence of the street as where everybody lives, and the evolution of the shop house as something that is very specific, specifically found in Southeast Asia. So here's the French presence, building boulevards, building wide streets in front of buildings. And on the right is the opera house in Saigon. But look at how big and wide this street is. This is much wider even than the street in front of the indoor market in Hanoi. And the pushback is, you know, we're going to use these streets any way we want. We're going to use the sidewalks any way we feel like using them. This is where the culture lies. This is not changing, and in fact, we're appropriating some of the things that may have come along with French colonization and turning them to our own uses, like the space outside the interior, the indoor market in Hanoi. It becomes appropriated by cultural uses that are much more common. And this is yours, right?
So you leave that on.
Okay.
Because we want to give them at least 10 minutes. Can we finish in 6?
Sure. Yeah.
So just to return to the larger outline and structure of the lecture, we looked at cast iron, we looked at the forms of cast iron, we looked at wrought iron, the Eiffel Tower. We are just touching in one slide on steel. We talked about the balance of compressive capacity versus tension. Cast iron was very bad in tension. Wrought iron was much better in tension. But then steel, the important thing to know about steel, with somewhere between 0.1% carbon and 2% carbon, steel has a beautiful high performance balance between compression and tension. And because of the capacity, the balance capacity of steel, pretty much the rest of the course is about what you can do with the miraculous high performance character of steel. So we'll get to that. The one thing that is better than steel is steel cable, because it's not about balancing compression and tension. Cables can only do tension. So the most ambitious structures ever produced are ones that avoid compression to the largest extent possible and does whatever you can do in tension. And cables are the champions of that. That said, European technologies, industrial era technologies, are kind of new to this game, but the Inca civilization were producing tensile structures long, and when the Spaniards arrived in the Americas, they couldn't get their horses to go over suspension bridges because they had never encountered anything like that before. To be continued. Kind of like the Eiffel Tower, we're throwing in the Brooklyn Bridge as a bonus thing because it was so revolutionary. We mentioned it previously. When it was built, it was the tallest building in the world. For most of its construction, it was overseen by Emily Roebling. And there it is, towering over Brooklyn and New York that were the two largest cities on the East Coast of the U.S. And it really is, we don't have time for any of this, so we're going to keep going. Now, one thing, what a question to leave you with is, what's next after steel? Well, some would say that the next revolutionary material is one that is sustainable. And so a quick word about bamboo. Here's a suspension bridge made out of bamboo, where the bamboo is being used in pure tension, as a cable form. A lot of these poles are being used in pure tension. Other poles are being used in pure compression. And bamboo, it turns out, is a lot like steel in terms of its strength to weight ratio, in terms of the balance between compressive and tensile capacities. It is very, very close to steel. There's a big difference between bamboo and steel. Steel does not grow on trees. Bamboo is a grass, and it is usable after 3 years. You can't use it once it gets to 5 years old. It's over the hill. Don't use it. And Wentworth has a close connection with the bamboo innovators of the world right now in the Green School in Bali. And this is them building that bridge over the river. But we don't have time to look at this. But.
So does that take vehicles, or is it just a pedestrian bridge?
It's a footbridge, but there are, so that's a view of the bridge there, us going over it. A lot of your colleagues in the upper levels are looking at what the formal structural capacities of bamboo are. And every year we build a bamboo structure somewhere. If they let us, we build it on the campus. So now back to you.
Yeah. I want to go back and, Robert, I think I turned this off. Okay, I'll use this. It's okay. I want to go back and remind you of the shop houses, because I see this as the pushback. You know, the French come in and colonize and they bring along iron, but that doesn't mean that's all there is. And the shop house or the tube house is so completely Southeast Asian, not just Vietnam, but China as well. And it's a response. It's a response to the rapid urbanization in the late 19th century, but it's also a response to how people live. That in fact, you may be coming in from the countryside and living in an urban area, but you don't lose your family structure, because they do evolve to contain families of several generations. And typically it's found in the older quarters of the cities, and would be a merchant's house on a long, narrow lot with the shop in front and life on the sidewalk, and then the living quarters in the back and upstairs. And these so-called tube houses could be as narrow as 2 meters, and that's only a little more than 6 feet. That's a little bit wider than a man. But would go back, say, 60 or 70 feet. And growing was through expanding upward, and that was a way of showing your family's wealth, that in fact your house could expand even on the narrow lot. You had a way to go, and it was up. And that preserved your family structure as well, because you could build in space for the extended family, whether it's several generations or other extended family. So as you move back in these spaces away from the shop in front, there would be lit courtyards open to the sky. And of course, the shop house is not the only response to the innovations of the 19th century. The iron structures that came along. But in about 1910, think of in Europe, World War I is approaching. But by 1910, Vietnamese architects are starting to come back from France, where they would go either to work or to be educated at L'École des Beaux-Arts, bringing back their ideas from an architectural education, but also incorporating what they knew about their own culture and also about climate. Because even if you go to France, educated as an architect, coming back to Vietnam means you're coming back to a different climate and you're coming back to a different culture. So climate, indoors and outdoors, kind of blends. Greenery grows everywhere. And Vietnamese architects respond, I think, to not just cultural issues, but climate issues and global issues as well. So the VTN firm designs what this is called the Bamboo House. This is Stacking Green, and I'll show you a section drawing. This is a drawing from their firm's website that shows you how the skin on the exterior that is concrete and vegetation acts as insulation. So not only is it green in that sense, but it also houses several generations of the family. And just to wind up with some contemporary architects in Vietnam who are using bamboo, the Wind and Water Cafe uses the bamboo structure that Robert has been talking about. But again, think about this. There's not a glazed enclosure. This building is, in fact, it's like a bridge. It's open. It's just a roof. It's completely open to the elements. And again, another firm working in Vietnam that is looking at vernacular buildings as a way of thinking about how buildings built today can respond to changing climate. So if there's a typhoon, or if you get the rains that wipe out, say, the plot that you're building on, you can rebuild. This material is not exotic. It doesn't have to be imported. It can be put together almost like an IKEA kit, rebuilt if it's destroyed by weather conditions. And there you have some of the details from Blooming Bamboo House. So just as a way of winding up, getting us from the 19th century into the 21st.
So thank you, Linda.
You're welcome.